Hello, everyone. These events are co-convened by UNESCO Roots, the Enslaved Peoples Project, and the Global Humanity for Peace Institute at the University of Wales Trinity St David. My name is Chateau Gill. I'm the director of the Institute, and I'm honored to have the opportunity to bring diverse speakers together and to moderate the flow of their dialogue. Now, to our program today. This is the fifth webinar. In the previous events, we covered themes like history, memories, collective trauma, the power of a narrative, the complexity and opportunity of a reparation. These are all still available through the Institute's YouTube channel. Now, today's conversation is special. If we focus on the UNESCO's Intergenerational Dialogue and Inquiry, or IDI. This program has been creating spaces for listening, for dialogue, for storying in global communities. We will hear the voices from four continents about the experience of healing, resilience, and community regeneration. This conversation is also timely, as all of us have been bearing witness to all forms of catastrophe, not least genocide, apartheid, killing of the innocent, and the displacement of the helpless. Many commentators have pointed out that alongside political tribalism and structural injustice, these atrocities are also fed by unacknowledged historical grievances, unaddressed collective suffering, and unattended transgenerational trauma. Cycles of violence have thus kept the wounds of humanity raw, festering our body, our heart, our thought, and our spirit. So in such troubled time, there's a greater need for hope, which we may find in the stories that our panelists will share momentarily. Now, to introduce the UNESCO Intergenerational Dialogue and Inquiry for Healing Program is our first speaker, Linda Tino Le Duan, who is the Deputy Chief of UNESCO Rights, Inclusion and Intercultural Dialogue Section. Linda, welcome.
Dr. Chateau Gill, thank you very much for the introduction. Good day to everyone. I am very honored to be here with you as the first speaker for this webinar. Today, I will be doing a presentation that we have prepared for you so that you can understand this very interesting collaboration that we have developed together with our different partners, the Gerand Hermes Foundation, the University of Wales Trinity St David, and the Fetzer Institute. Today, I'll be talking about collective healing, social justice, and global well-being as part of a joint goal that UNESCO and the partners have been trying to achieve over a period of several years that we have been designing this and in the implementation that will follow. Of course, with a host of many different partners and working with different communities. So let me first start with a quote from one of my favorite writers, James Baldwin. History is not merely something to be read, and it does not refer merely or even principally to the past. On the contrary, the great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, are unconsciously controlled by it in many ways, and history is literally present in all that we do. It could scarcely be otherwise, since it is to history that we owe our frames of reference, our identities, and our aspirations. Powerful words from such a powerful man, and I hope that we will reflect on this as we go along with the presentation. Next slide, please. Dr. Gill talked about the UNESCO Roots of Enslaved Peoples Project. This is the framework through which we designed the initiative. This is a flagship activity of UNESCO, which was founded in 1994. The following objectives are to deconstruct the discourses based on the concept of race that justify these systems of exploitation, to promote the contributions of people of African descent to the general progress of humanity, to question the social, cultural, and economic inequalities inherited from this tragedy. Across different regions, UNESCO is working with different partners, research institutes, governments, civil society, and communities to ensure that history and memory are part and parcel of this collective memory that we are trying to highlight in this project. Lest we forget, UNESCO is here together with the partners to look at how we can learn from the lessons of this sad part of our history. Next slide, please. To contextualize what the Collective Healing Initiative is about, I would like to show you what are the different mandates through which we have developed this project. So this Collective Healing Initiative is, of course, inscribed within the broader aims of the UN Decade for People of African Descent, which is ending next year. It is also in line with the UNESCO medium-term objectives that include youth as a focus group, Africa as a focus region, and gender equality as a global priority of UNESCO's activities. And some of you may know, UNESCO has developed the annual Global Forum Against Racism and Discrimination. This is a yearly event where we convene different stakeholders from all parts of the world to come together, look at the state of the art, build partnerships together, and the roots of enslaved peoples is a big part of this global forum. This includes the UNESCO Roots of Enslaved Peoples. And next year, we will be very pleased to work with you in the celebration of the 30 years anniversary of this project. And of course, from all of these, we have developed this UNESCO Partnership Initiative on Healing, Justice, and Well-being. So what is it about? Next slide, please. It's a comprehensive process developed jointly with the partners, and it has different phases. It's not necessarily linear, but we are trying to make it as comprehensive and as inclusive as possible. So first, we start with an intergenerational dialogue and inquiry in global communities. So this is a series of different dialogues that we are undertaking together with the different partners. And from these learnings, we are doing the development of futures forming leadership that we are also developing with our partners. And from there, we will endeavor to establish the UNESCO policy brief on community regeneration. So from all the different exchanges that we have concluded with the different global communities, we will come up with this policy brief, again, in consultation with these different communities. And of course, as an outcome, we would like to aspire to accomplish this aim towards collective healing, social justice, and global well-being. Next slide, please. The process is, of course, a co-creation, because we would like to have global youth as part of this process. Why? It's because 53% of the world's population is under 30. In the sub-Saharan Africa, under 30 is amount to 70% of its population. And as earlier mentioned to you, youth is a focus group in all of UNESCO's activities across the different sectors. Youth, of course, is regarded as knowledge holders and partners. And as agents of change, we count on them as our powerful partners in this endeavor. We treasure the young, but trust the elder. It is, of course, imperative to engage young people in this process of co-creating a better world. Next slide, please. So, of course, we look at this initiative through cultural wisdom and place-based knowledge. Everything is built on the communities. It is embodied and placed and cultured wisdom, which is at the forefront of this initiative. We look at traditional knowledge systems. We learn from our elders. And through these lessons that we learn from them over generations and generations, this contributes to resilience, healing, and well-being. Of course, this is shared across the generations, and this is where we think that sustainability is being underlined as part of the collective and a continuous process. Of course, the community's restoration and regeneration is the principal element that we put in this project. Next slide, please. Now, as you see, I'm very happy to see also many familiar faces in this webinar, and some of them are in this photo. We strive to work with different partners across regions. Next slide, please. And this is a list of the objectives that the Intergenerational Dialogue and Inquiry for Healing Initiative aims to achieve. So we aim to share experiences of common legacies of dehumanization. What's racism? What's oppression? The everyday racism, microaggressions, unconscious bias that we experience, that we are subjected to. Some are also victims of institutional racism. We try to identify common pathways forward through reconnecting to cultural wisdom and place-based knowledge, as earlier mentioned in the previous slide. This also offers the opportunities for dialogue and listening as we look at how young people and the elder ones are sharing what their experiences are, what lessons they want to impart with each other. And then we also try to promote a public recognition that every generation has a role to play in improving the quality of communal life. It's a give and take dialogue between the different generations. Again, co-creation is imperative in this process. These are spaces where youth's agency is very important. They participate and they are responsible. They also co-design and they co-own this initiative. Of course, as we said, across different regions, this initiative therefore strengthens cultural identity and solidarity across the divides. And at the current situation that we are in, this process is very, very important in promoting mutual understanding and tolerance. In the end, what do we want to do? We want to inspire the whole community's shared vision for the common future and the roots to achieve it. Next slide, please. So I think we need to contextualize why this healing initiative is important. It's because by sharing, telling, and witnessing the suffering that communities, individuals have endured, it's very, very important. Externalizing what we have lived as experiences is important in this process. So trauma, it could be conscious, unconscious, and it actually liberates us when we share this with other people. So silence is a common symptom of trauma. And these sharing experiences is the best way to come up with the language that is shared by all the participants in these dialogues. Here we also see that intergenerational dialogue allows the shift from silently living out personal and collective sufferings to mutual telling and mutual witnessing. It is through the sharing of these sufferings that we find this common language and a bond that gives us this sense of collectivity, the sense of belonging with each other in these spaces for dialogues. And of course, we build this collective narrative together. we find out that this person has probably the same kind of suffering that I have, and that it gives us this feeling of being one, being united, and sharing these different experiences. With caring, listening, deep dialogue, and mutual inquiry that involve young and older adults to reflect on the past, present, and future together, healing can happen through restoring wholeness and well-being. Next slide, please. So you can see some images of what we have done with different groups. So you see, these are spaces that actually require courage, because to share your experiences, to share the past that is sometimes you want to forget, that's bravery. But that is what we are trying to strive. It's the freedom that we get out of these exchanges. We see that these are opportunities for storying and listening. And this is part of this dialogue that we are talking about. And then from these narratives, we find the humanness, the humanity that is spread and shared in the different spaces that we create. We understand how elders perceive their present lived realities in connection to the past trauma. And therefore, in the end, we rediscover cultural wisdom, spiritual practices, and place-based resources for resilience, restoration, reconciliation, and regeneration. In other words, we co-create all these different spaces by sharing what we have lived together. Whether these are bad experiences, we learn from them, and then we build these different values of resilience, restoration, reconciliation, and regeneration. Next slide, please. So the process is on seven steps, and it is always customized with local partners. There is not one size fits all. There's always a consultation. As you can see from the slide, there is diversity, and there's for both the young adults and the community elders. We need them to be motivated, interested, willing to listen, curious, and of course, open. Next slide. So we have a group of facilitators who do the introduction to the spaces. So these are the courageous and the caring and courageous spaces that we talked about. There has to be some the standards to highlight the ethics of respect and inclusion. We are here to share, so we are giving parts of ourselves in this session. So there has to be listening, dialogue, and inquiring. And then in the end, we leave the ample time for co-creation. Next slide, please. Out of this sharing, we build capacities, we enhance the skills. While we listen and while we share ourselves, we build this two-way traffic of building the trust and the bonding. So we have to have the sensitivity, the respect, the inclusion. And of course, we build the trust, and then we also deepen the art of facilitation with the co-participants. These are one-to-one conversations. Yes, this next slide, please. One-to-one conversations is very enriching. We are here to listen to each other. There are no rules. There are no scripts. It's I listen to you, you listen to me. You put yourselves, you develop the empathy. You put yourselves into the shoes of the others, of the other one in front of you. You also try to understand. You are not there to judge. You are there to understand, to listen, and to share what you have to share yourself. Next, please. And then we build the focus group conversations, and that's where we form a bigger circle where elders share their experiences and insights from the conversations. And at the same time, the young people share in turn their own experiences and conversations with the elders. And extracting from that, we get the cultural wisdom and the place-based practices of resiliency and well-being. A dialogue about the group reflection on these learnings ensue. And then mutual gratitude, thanking everyone for their generosity and their sincerity for sharing their own experiences is, of course, part and parcel of this process. Next slide, please. Of course, through these dialogue spaces, we generate new knowledge, new understanding, new narratives. What are the common themes and what makes us also different? Unity in diversity is part of these dialogue spaces. What are the emergent ideas and core practices? So we see by collecting these experiences, we come up with a new understanding, a common understanding about collective trauma and collective healing. And then from there, we start to think, what can we do? What is a forward-looking perspective and aiming to restore, reconcile, and regenerate the community? Next slide, please. And so this is where we go to a bigger circle, the healing and regenerating community. We invite all stakeholders to a public meeting. We get different perspectives from them as they listen to the core group from the elders and the young. We also get the perspectives from others who are not part of that process, but are willing to learn from this initiative. So there are community stakeholders, and of course, young adults present the processes of and the insights from the dialogue and the inquiry. And then we engage the whole community now in this bigger circle on what we can do. We propose ideas and see what are the existing challenges, so that now with the bigger set of actors, we go forward towards healing and regeneration. Next slide, please. Of course, the ultimate aim is to share and return the gifts of the treasures of the community. We want to co-construct the shared visions for a humane and caring world. And because we have different stakeholders also joining in these bigger circles, we propose institutional conditions for systemic transformation for the community and beyond. And look at what are the concrete pathways for collective journeys of healing, well-being, and co-flourishing. Next slide, please. I would like to end with a quote from, I'm sure many of you have Maya Angelou as your favorite poet. History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again. Next slide, please. I just would like to share a short anecdote. When I was in London, when I was in this group, it was really very touching. Some of them have shared that their lives have changed with these dialogue spaces, with this healing initiative. And we really hope that this can be scaled up with other youth communities, with other elder communities. And so what are the next steps? We plan to share this with different sites and extend the program to 10 global communities. We hope that in the planned second decade of the International Decade for People of African Descent, this is being planned within the Permanent Forum of People of African Descent, this initiative will be given a role as a best practice in this Federation of Civil Society Initiatives. We would like also to host intergenerational dialogue sessions in the different international events, including the Global Forum Against Racism and Discrimination. Right now, with the team, we are looking at the co-creation of a UNESCO Futures Leadership Program. And of course, in the long run, we would like to nurture more young facilitators to hold the spaces and invite more partners to contribute to social transformation and flourishing of all. So, Thank you very much. I hope this is useful for you. And I give the floor now again back to Dr. Gill. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Linda. This is, I think the audience will join me in appreciating such a detailed and a clear outline of the IDI Intergenerational Dialogue and Inquiry Program. Now, let's turn to our community speakers. So with us today, like Linda has hinted, there are elders and there are young participants. So with us today are two elders and two young participants. The elders are Dr. Diane Regisford from Oxford, UK, and Dr. Gloria Patricia Moreno from Indigenous Land in Colombia. And the young participants, we have Casey Overton from the US and Ojeya Yaki Oluwaseyi from Nigeria. So you will see more about their bio in the chat, but let's listen to their story. So Diane, could we start with you and hear your experience of the IDI? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sherto. Good evening to all. Let me say greetings. I know we're tuning in from all over the world, and therefore there will be time differences. Following that very detailed presentation, I'd like to invite some spaciousness into this inquiry, for it is a collective inquiry for us all. And as we do this in time-honored tradition, I invite all of us to just pause for this work of healing centuries of harm. Requires spaciousness. It requires that we engage beyond the cerebral and come into our bodies. As we saw in that James Baldwin quote, everything that we have lived, the traumas, they live within us intergenerationally. So it's not just the dialogue, but it's also what we carry in us, encoded in our DNA. And so this invitation to all of us today is to soften our gaze, and if you are so inspired, to close your eyes. And this time-honored tradition is to call in our ancestors, those who came before us, living or transitioned to other realms. To, as you are all muted now, just call them in, sense into who is walking with you, who is present on this webinar with you, who would you like to be present with you? Those that came before, and also those who are in front of us, our descendants, for they are watching. And as this IDI inquiry process explores, there is this interconnection and interbeing between the generations. So I'll just pause for a moment as we do this. And I invite you to call the names out loud, call them out loud. Speak them into the room. And as you do so, I will offer here an evocation. It's a form of prayer, it's a form of incantation, which is based on the Bantu African philosophy, which is Ubuntu. Ubuntu, without you, I do not exist. Ubuntu, without you, I do not exist. Ubuntu, without you, I do not exist. Thank you. This is a clarion call. It's an evocation. It's a hope for the future, that we come back to this way of knowing. And this, for me, is what this invitation to participate as an elder in the IDI process opened up. This possibility of returning to deeply embedded knowledge systems, ways of transferring not only experience, wisdom, the materia that makes up our being, our ways of seeing, our ways of knowing. These are all ways of knowing as far as I see it. And in my experience journeying with the young people who came, mostly London-based, but came first to Oxford, we sat on a Saturday in a space where we first came together in a circle. And whilst there was clear respect and honor for the elders offered, this was designed as a participatory process led by the young people. So when we came out of the circles, we were one-on-one, sometimes one to two with a young person. And I had the privilege and honor of sitting with two young women on that day. I was deeply touched by their probing, by their curiosity, and by their openness, their willingness to receive. It was when we got to the stakeholder meeting that you heard described here in terms of the process in London that we saw how the young people began to share with each other an outward expression of what they had internalized and what they carried home with them. And it was very clear to me that some of the questions that unfolded, not only through their voices, but through my own experience, will lead us time and time again to create spaces for care. Because in the healing, as has been mentioned before, the retelling of our stories is powerful. Through my own work in evoking belonging, this is what we do. We use narrative inquiry. We connect it to imaginative voyaging processes to be able to sense deeply, to embody, to enliven, to encounter. An encounter we did. I was left with questions such as the following, and I'd like to close my offering here with these three questions of continuing unfolding inquiry that reside within me. The resources required for such community-led processes include, from my perspective, a container to hold them. And this container, given that we are looking at local knowledges, even that question, local, I was introduced as being from Oxford. I do not consider myself to be from Oxford. I identify as a first generation Black woman of African Caribbean heritage. There is ancestry in my lineage where many were forcibly removed from their ancestral lands. So it is highly problematic for me to consider that I am from Oxford. I'm currently based in Oxford. But we have here, as I am first generation, my children live here, and I think of our great-grandchildren to come. By the time our great-grandchildren come, that encoding, if we agree, and we don't all necessarily need to agree, but if we agree that we carry seven generations genetic encoding, this intergenerational trauma that has been mentioned, and many other things, intergenerational knowings within us. By the time we get to my great-grandchildren, they will be, I've traced this back through my lineage, they will be the first generation to not have the imprint of slavery, the Atlantic slave trade within their encoding. And so the question I ask is how we care for each other as we unfold into these narratives. Trauma comes up in many forms. And yes, we understand that the voicing of our stories is healing, but without the adequate provision of trauma-informed support. So it's not only the container, it's not only the money. I also believe these initiatives need to be financed. They need to be, and this could be through a community fund or trust. They need to be financed, but we also need the care support. And this is really fundamental. Secondly, I'd like to ask how we document these processes. What will our great-grandchildren inherit? What will our children inherit? How will we, those of us who are not sitting in the circles, how will we hear what our young people are grappling with? This, for me, is very important as we continue to unfold this emergent design. For if we are truly being co-creative in this approach, we, again, the spaciousness I spoke about at the beginning, will need space for emergent outcomes. And therefore, maybe the word outcomes is not even relevant here. It's a journey. Thirdly, the inquiry question that I hold is, how do we develop cultures of equitable inquiry? What does equitable inquiry look like and feel like? It's one thing to be given a space at the table, but when we are engaging processes designed to address, engage, redress systematic oppression that lives on in every encounter throughout the day, in various forms. The shaping of the questions, how we hold those questions, how we unfold them, how we come together to co-create new forms of knowing in an equitable way so that it's not extractive, is a fundamental question that I would like to further explore as we go through this webinar. With that, I thank you. I will hand over now to Gloria.
Bueno, buen día para todos y todas. Agradecer al momento y al espacio por darnos la oportunidad de poder estar y compartir estos espacios tan importantes desde la participación de nuestros mayores y nuestros jóvenes en diálogos de saberes y aprendizajes. Me presento, soy Gloria Patricia Moreno. Soy médica tradicional de resguardo indígena Cañamomo Loma Prieta, consejera mayor del Consejo de Sabios y Sabias del Departamento de Caldas. Hago parte de la estructura organizativa de mi resguardo Cañamomo Loma Prieta, el cual se encuentra ubicado en los municipios de Supía y de Río Sucio, Caldas, Colombia, con una población de hermanos indígenas.
I am Dr. Gloria Patricia Moreno, a traditional indigenous healer. I come from Caldas province, where we have indigenous communities, where we have an organized process, where we started participating in different spaces and international meetings. There's something very important that I would like to underline, and it's the reason why I wanted to participate in one of each of these meetings and dialogues, which is sharing the experience of Caldas. And that the work we are doing to come back to the healing in our context. Our experience is a beautiful experience where we have been able to encounter young people together with our elders we have been able to hear their experiences, their stories that have marked their lives with pain, with sadness. But thanks to the wisdom of our elders, we have been able to keep fighting. We, as indigenous people, wanted to take one of each of these experiences to every space possible to motivate our young people to have them come back to our roots, to recover traditional practices, starting from psychology, energy, and from the spiritual context. This is what we have been taken to different spaces, places, where our universe has given us the opportunity to share our experiences, teaching, but also learning from our brothers and sisters, learning from the experiences in other territories, other regions. And this has taken us to find the strategies to keep being present in those spaces. Throughout these meetings, elders and young people have met, and they have been very important, not only for me, but also for the young people that have been present in these word circles, where they have been able to share and hear elders. They have shared two different worlds, a world where our elders who have survived, fought along their lives, and that have been fighting to be able to remain on their land. Our young people have a different way of seeing things, different way of thinking. That's why these meetings have allowed us to know what's happening in this moment in the world. This way, we have been able to have our young people listen, get interested in learning from the elders, and our elders have kept giving this knowledge to different populations. Listening to our elders share their history, reviving their lives, has been something that we that have been walking through this path, we have been able to reflect on what are we doing for our youth, and we have been more aware of the difficulties they face. This experience has been very important, and it's been very, very beautiful. Because it has allowed us to work on the healing, to come back to harmony. And this is where public health and institutional health professionals, together with our traditional doctors, healers, midwives, have developed different strategies to come back to harmony. This experience is the one that have allowed us, the indigenous people of Caldas, getting back to balance, come back to our roots, and That's what we want to take to our neighbor territories in Colombia. This requires knowledge and requires monitoring. During the meetings, we have always focused on listening and focused on the word. Young people have sat to listen to our elders, and our elders, with great patience and wisdom, have used the word to tell their stories, give advice to our young people. So it's been a process that has been utterly beautiful and that has allowed me to learn from other cultures and learn from our brothers or sisters and keep listening to our elders. In each moment, we learned and we were aware of the different circumstances or difficulties that affect our neighboring territories. We, as spiritual healers and spiritual elders, met colleagues that were able to raise their voice, that gathered the confidence to be able to express themselves through pain, through crying. Still nowadays, we see how violence keeps affecting our youth. Our youth is losing their identity. They see in the modern world, in urban areas, they see how, or they have been shown, they perceive these areas as a place where they have more opportunities to make more money, but what they find there is lots of violence. And in these circles, they have been able to drink from the wisdom of their elders to come back to the territorial peace. In my people, in Cañan Momuco, we had a lot of violence present with a lot of strength. We have been able to heal the territory, heal the people living in this territory, and we think this is history. Nonetheless, when we speak with the people living in these areas, this is still a reality for many Colombian brothers. It is still a reality for many indigenous peoples in Colombia, and this affects our youth. Living this experience and feeling how we, with our spiritual practices, can help, can intervene from the collective to the individual, without losing our roots, our origins, and always carrying our knowledge with responsibility, love, and without forgetting the heritage that our elders have left us. That's why this experience has been very interesting. It's been a beautiful experience. And even though many of these youngsters have left their culture behind, they still have the will to sit and listen to their elders and still want to come back to their roots. And this is the work that we do in each of the meetings. We share the word, we share the wisdom. And for us, from our originary law, from a spiritual knowledge that comes from our elders, we're able of offering this knowledge to the people that needs it. This present, this past, and the future is what invites us to reflect. To reflect on how are we going to come back to the origin of the how to recover our different ways of healing, how to come back to spirituality, and how to connect with the rest of spiritual beings and our elders that have always taught us that the grandparents are the ones that are going to walk together with us. So we are calling to come back to our roots. We want to guide our youth so they don't take the easy path and have them listen to their elders, to the advice and the of our elders, taking advantage of their wisdom. I want to thank very dearly all the beings that have been present in one of and each of our meetings. From their knowledge, their cultural practices have contributed and participated in these spaces, these circles, and intergenerational meetings that we consider being so important. We are so amazed to see our youth learning in these circles, listening to the elders. We have to work more with our youth, always in the company and of our elders. Thank you very much, and I wish you a beautiful day.
Thank you very much, and this is a perfect time for the voice of our young people to come in. Casey, may I invite you to share your experience? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sherto. I'm going to pause for a second, and if there's any way I can get an indication that our translators are ready before I begin, I'm going to try to move swiftly and be brief to leave time for some conversation. But I'm not sure if that's something I can see in the chat. If not, then I will go ahead and move forward in hopes that everything can be captured through our translators. But I'm grateful. Okay, awesome. Thank you. I'm grateful for the opportunity. I'm grateful to be able to present with everyone. My name is Casey Overton. I am in Powhatan lands, now known as Richmond, Virginia, in the United States of America. And the circle, as we began to affectionately call our dialogue space, became something that was very sacred to us and very important to us, we found that we arrived to the space with tensions. We found that we arrived to the space with some preconceived notions, lots of emotions. And in that, we found ourselves still pursuing and achieving fellowship, camaraderie, and connection through our circle. With that, we found that our circle, I found that our circle was therapeutic, and it was important in that sense. And it also did not seem foreign to me within our culture, within Black American culture. Spaces like our circle exist in cookouts, spaces like our circle exist over games of dominoes and spades, spaces like our circle exists in living rooms and gatherings over holidays at elders' homes. So the experience felt familiar in a way that was very comforting. It felt intentional in a way that allowed for important conversations to happen that I think could have happened and would happen as we take advantage of Black gathering spaces. But where I found our conversations reaching not quite an impasse, but where I found space opening up for further questioning and perhaps questions emerging in our circle of how we move forward as a community, I found those to be questions of power, questions around resource distribution, questions around the state, questions around the structuring of our economies. And those became the questions that we were probably most challenged by in our circle, wondering, we can gather, knowing that we can gather and we can discuss the trauma that we have faced, and we can talk about all of the violence that our peoples have seen. And a lot of that is known to us. A lot of that has been recorded. Whether or not it's platformed in the way that it should be is a different conversation. But we know of our trauma, we know of our pain. And so the questions around repair became those that really just caused us to slow down and caused us to yearn for more intentional space to explore these questions around repair and redistribution. And so some of these are the questions that I hope to bring to this space today. And truly, just how long do we continue to tolerate a lack of inclination towards repair? How long do we continue to allow our soils allow us to not have a say over what happens with and to soil that is drenched in our ancestors' blood? How long do we allow for resources to continue to be dispossessed from our communities? These are the questions that, as much as we want to heal, we are also rightfully wanting answers to, because the healing that takes place, while we are in need of spiritual healing, we are in need of social healing, we understand that a lot of that is mediated through material. And so all of these sort of metaphysical or immaterial modes where we're hoping to see this healing, we understand it's mediated all the same through material. So for those questions of resource, capital, material, statehood, borders, where is it that we can begin to have those conversations with people in power, and understanding that the dialogue need not only be between folks who have faced violence, and perhaps there need not be dialogue with those who have been aggressors and causers of violence. But at what point do we insist on repair, and how is it that we can best do that? Because it seems that no way that oppressed communities respond to the violence that has been meted out against them is the correct way to respond to harm and violence, although these communities have been completely dispossessed and disempowered. So I leave us with some of these questions. When can repair begin? Whose responsibility is it to begin the work of repair? Whose responsibility is it to be in dialogue around how this repair takes place? Whose responsibility is it to begin to sow peace in our communities and begin to restore the resources that have been dispossessed in our communities? And with those questions just on the table, not necessarily for our communal discussion, but just for folks to take with them, I will pass this over to Seyi in Nigeria. Thank you all.
Hey, I'm afraid you need to unmute. Thank you.
Okay, apologies. So good evening, everyone. Good afternoon, good morning from wherever you are in any part of the world. My name is Shay. And I think for myself and my team, and which includes five awesome ladies, I think one thing that motivated us to be a part of this was it was kind of necessary because within our space in Nigerian, you know, society, there's hardly any conversation because over here, you know, the elderly are very almost sacred. You never really get to, you know, look at them or look into their eyes. More or less having a conversation with them. But I think the dialogue and everything, intergenerational conversation, give us an opportunity to look into the minds of the elderly. And it was necessary because it was our chance to, as it was put in the circular, tap into the human library. And I think that was exactly what we did because it gave us like, a moment of clarity on a lot of things that we kind of had uncertainties about before. So we were able to not just speak and hear from them, we were able to converse. It was a two-way thing. And it was kind of beautiful because a lot of things that were abstract with regards to the IDI thing became more concrete, and we got a chance to sort of see ourselves through the eyes of the elderly, of these older generation. Because as I said earlier, there's like a cold war between the older and the younger generation, especially in Nigeria. Sociopolitically, we do not agree on a lot of things. Politically, we do not agree on a lot of things socially. But then through the conversations, we realized that they had dreams like we do now. They had their flaws, they had their uncertainties, and ultimately it was the reversion to themselves, to within, like an introspection of some sort that helped them to traverse the world that they existed in as young people. So I think I interviewed a beautiful woman who is like in her late 80s or early 90s, I'm not really certain, but she was the oldest elder in the room. And she had shared stories about when she was young and she was in school. And she needed to translate her texts into her local dialect, which was Yoruba, before she could understand the content of the text. And it was necessary for her to go to school because she wanted to sort of like have a life for herself, because that was the narrative that dominated her time. And she existed in a time when colonialism was at its peak. So it was for you to become somebody in that society, then they were told that you have to, you know, get sort of subscribing to the Western education. And with Western education came like some kind of without alienation from the traditional ways, the cultural ways, the ancestral ways. And she had to leave her immediate enclave with her family because her school, I think her school was like very far distance, and she had to leave on her own and everything. And even still at 90, she remembers all of the monumental periods of her life, like when the first time she left the shores of Lagos on a ship in pursuit of, I think it was a nursing degree in the UK. And she remembered the name of the person who she shared her cabin with. Now, why was that important to me? I felt it was remarkable because this was an old woman who still recollects everything. And I myself, I was struggling with, you know, remembering things that I read probably yesterday and everything. And it gave me a moment of just introspection to sort of like look within and try to, is there something I can take away from it? And there definitely was a lot of things I could take away from there. Other highlights within the spaces that we kind of conversed, there were stories about, I think one of our elders shared the story about how her mom had tattoos and she grew up in a world where there were tribal marks in her society. And she was confused about what exactly were these things. And one day she was bold enough to ask her mom, like, "Mom, why is there a tattoo on you? And why do people have tribal marks?" And her mom shared that tattoos were sort of created in the Yoruba society as a form of identification during the height of slavery and colonialism, because people could be taken or snatched at any point in time on their way to the farm, on their way to the market, on their way anywhere. But if you have a tattoo or a tribal mark, they call it tribal mark, but more like they were like identification marks, you would be able to be identified by your kin and your family. And most likely, it's even the privileged people that had access to those kinds of beautification things and that sort of saved them from being carted away into, you know, Europe and the likes and everywhere and America as slaves. So for me, I took a moment back and was like, this is crazy, because I've always looked at tribal marks and it's kind of common, although it's already dying now as a common feature of our cultural space. It was eye-opening because this shows the struggle that they must have endured, the uncertainty of coming back home from the farm. Meanwhile, me being 20-something in Lagos, the things I have, to an extent, better security than they did, because nothing was sort of promised in those days. You could leave home and not come back. And they lived on sort of very thin threads that, oh, you could be lost today and there's nothing your family can really do about it. And all those stories sort of shed light on the struggles of our elders within our societies, although they don't really get to share because, as I said, we culturally, or I would say locally, we do not really get to have that kind of relationship with our elder. However, I think ultimately what I can conclude is this. Values were important to the elderly, and that's something I think young people can tap into. I know we live material, everything is about results, everything is about you know, what you look like. Consumerism has taken over everything that we are now. But I think for them, what separates them from us, well, the first thing that actually sort of made me see myself through the eyes of the elders that I spoke to was the fact that they had dreams like I did. They had fears like I do now. They had uncertainties, as I said earlier. But I think one thing I could take away to sort of change the trajectory of how things are going for me is tap more into the value systems. The value systems are everything, because one of the elders shared a story about how his career as a lawyer took sort of grew because it was one of the first moments in his career that he had to be humble. So humility helped him to achieve some kind of progress in his career. He was the first big case he had, because he's a lawyer, was through a connection, you know, he had with an understudy, someone he was sort of a mentor to in while they were in school. But now that they're out of school, he has, there was a need for him to move his practice to the other, to the next level. And he didn't really know how to go about it. And as, you know, Providence would have it, he had the chance to meet someone who he was sort of a senior to in every sense of the word. And his humility in the moment to listen to what the so-called younger and less, how would you say, he had every right to feel above that person, but he didn't, because wisdom prevailed and honest, and his humility sort of stepped in and saved him in a sense, because through that contact, his legal practice moved to the next level. I think all those things sort of make me ask myself a huge question, which would be like, how would I take this moving forward? How would I, you know, learn from all the stories? Because the future is still there and is waiting for us. And all we have right now is the present. But I think one thing young people should take away within the, you know, the audience, I think, is we still need the past, regardless of how, you know, fast we think we are. We know we're the Gen Zs and we're smart and we're everything. There are gems that exist within the within our history, as aptly put in the quote by James Baldwin, which said, like, it is through history that we frame our aspirations, and aspirations speak to the future. And I remember there was a story, although it was this story didn't come up through the actual dialogue, but I think I took the spirit of the dialogue and I had conversation with elderly people. So outside of it, I had a conversation with an elderly man who shared a story about the concept of Ori in Ifa religion. Ifa religion is the actual philosophical source of the Yoruba culture. And within the Ifa religion, there's a concept of Ori. Ori roughly translates your head, but in the context of the religion, it speaks to your personal spirit, your personal mind that was basically instilled in you by your creator. And your Ori basically is the path through which you achieve your higher self. And your higher self would be something like, you know, your salvation from your current state of mind, because we all want to be somewhere better than, we all want to improve and change our lives and sort of live the life that we all think we ought to be living. So according to the Fire religion, the answer to your questions are within your spirit, which is personal to you, which accompanied you on the day of your creation. And I would love to round up with this. I think I have a question maybe to Diane, because I recognize the Caribbean and West African connection there. She probably understands what I'm talking about, but I think my question to her would be like, I think, how young were you when you had those realizations that led you to who you are today? Because from your appearance alone, I can really see what you represent. So I think with that, I would round off my section. Thank you very much for listening, and God bless everybody.
Thank you, Shayi. Before Diane and Gloria and the elders respond, and we will also want to invite Casey to join in. Perfect. So what a rich panel, what rich sharing of experience. One thing I took away just now is that intergenerational dialogue really involves deep listening. It's so deep, it becomes an invitation for something new to come to be, something new that already seeks to be born. In listening, you invite it out. So I think in hearing from all the sharing is that quality of listening allows the future to emerge, to unfold. So that's very beautiful. Shayi has a question for the elders, Diane and possibly Gloria, but also Casey and Diane put some questions to us all. And there are questions coming from the audience. We have about 10 minutes. How we can pack that in, I don't know. Let's try to be brief. Diane, have a go.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And yes, for spaces for deep listening, this enables connection. And I feel without that, the sense of belonging is somehow is eroded, you know, without that. And so voices that have been silenced for generations by dominant cultures and forces, this is really fundamental. Brother Shay, thank you so much for your question. Can I just ask you to repeat it so I make sure I can answer it properly? How young was I? That's all I remember.
Okay. So basically, I was asking, like, how young were you when you realized that this was where you needed to go in terms of, like, your beliefs, who you are right now? So basically.
Thank you so much. Well, I don't even know how to start to answer that question. I don't think I have a milestone in terms of age, but I can absolutely say to you that this yearning for belonging has been with me ever since I've known myself. I had the absolute joy and privilege of being born in Oxford, but 3 days before my first birthday, my parents moved to Zambia, and I celebrated my first birthday on the banks of the Victoria Falls. So from that moment, I have been exposed through my parents and through the culture that they cultivated, which is to say, these are your roots, but you're going to meet many people of different cultures. Open up yourself to receive the gifts of these different cultures. And so I've known that as part of my being, and I have chosen, as I'll fast forward now to very recent times, in the last decade, I would say, where I no longer quest for belonging. And through my work, which I take as my life work, I evoke belonging every day through my being. I consider my body as a mobile museum. This is living history that is co-created every day. So in essence, I posit in my work and my research and through my practice, I call this the urban indigen. I am pulling forth from my ancestral path. I'm an artist, I'm continually creating. And then also looking forward to say that we are co-creating belonging as a cultural practice in every breath, in every step. And so this is why I find it difficult to put a milestone, but I just feel it's a continuum. And the spiritual dimension you saw at the beginning, I opened with this invocation. Aha. So my work is evoking belonging. So I would say evocation. And within that is this call to all of us to consider what culture means for us, how we are continually co-creating our ways of seeing, our ways of being, our ways of doing, in a nutshell, culture. Thank you for the question, Brother Shane.
Thank you, Ma.
And Gloria, Indigenous people always have such a strong sense of belonging to their land. Would you also briefly and touch upon the question that Shay has offered to you? I think she's probably had to listen to a different channel for the interpretation. Okay, so while we wait for Gloria, I do want to highlight a question coming from the audience. Charles Ogino, I'm sorry if I pronounce your name wrong, he said something really important. He said, from your own experience, how can institutions promote meaningful involvement of youth and elder in promoting their meaningful participation in sustainable peace building, healing, and well-being? I think in some ways, you will talk about how UNESCO has created space within communities for this meaningful exchange and a beautiful listening. So how do we invite institutions to equally engage young people? Do you have any suggestions? And Casey, I probably will start with you, because I, when in the dialogue circle, I heard your voice very vocal about the institution and structure. Please, Casey.
Thank you for passing that over to me, Sherto. I think something that comes to mind first, which probably echoes much of what I've been saying, is just being able to resource youth and elders alike to be able to come to these spaces. I think about, for youth in particular, a lot of their existence, like, it occurs within institutions. So for their participation to be authentic, what are other institutions' relationship with their institutions of learning? How can we create space within those institutions of learning that young folks are compulsory or must attend? How can those spaces be spaces that allow for youth to truly participate with and in dialogue with the rest of society. Sometimes it can seem like these institutions actually serve a purpose to kind of sequester youth away and isolate them from the public square, isolating them from activity that's happening, where decisions are made, where there can be influence. So what could it look like for institutions that youth must be in, if they must are, if schooling must be compulsory, and education is certainly important, without downplaying the importance of education, what could it mean for there to be space and freedom allowed for youth to actually and meaningfully participate as decision makers with the rest of wider adult society?
Yeah. Mm. So anyone would like to, Diane, before I let you come in, I'd really like to hear what Shay could add to this youth perspective. Shay, don't forget to unmute. I'm sorry.
I think Casey captured it properly. The only way for institutions to sort of help, because I hold them very much accountable as much as government, the colonial government, because currently one thing with this, I would have to say one thing with all of these things we're talking about, including, you know, slavery, colonialism, eradication of the roots and everything, as is a continuous thing. And it's currently taking a different form, because in Nigeria currently, I think one thing we face mostly is say the mediocrity that sort of dominates all of the spaces that are occupied by the elderly. So it includes government, it includes institutions, as you said. Meanwhile, down below where the younger generation operates, we seem to have more organization. We seem to have more, I don't know how to put it. We seem to just be a bit more put together in the Nigerian, let's say, social political space. So it's very important for institutions to sort of let the voices of the young people be heard, no matter how, whatever the assumptions you have about this generation and everything. It's very important for you to let them come in and hear what they have to say, which is one thing this space has done for us. But it might be a very hard sell, because you have to rub shoulders with, and the politics in Nigeria, and that's one thing. It's also a political thing, and the political is also very personal. So somehow I don't really understand how we can thread that needle, because, and it really needs to be threaded. So the institutions need to let us in a sense, and just hear what we have to say, and don't just discredit anything because you have assumptions about young people. So I think that's what I have to add to that.
Thank you. Now, Diane and Gloria, are you able to participate now, or can you join in while the translation is happening?
Bueno, hablando un poco desde cómo nosotros hemos vuelto a esa sanación.
Talking about how we came back to our healing and about what's been all our generation. We have tried to keep our ancestral practices, coming back to the mountains, to the rivers, connect with the great strength of motherland. And that's what has given us back peace, tranquility, and has made possible for our youth and children to heal their wounds, the wounds created sometimes by earlier generations or inflicted in earlier generations. Violence and the war that we have lived is what has taken us to come back to our practices, to our cultures, and this way teaching our youth and children the indigenous strength that It's in the middle of the circle of our spirituality, going back to the mountains. They connect with Mother Earth. And we have fought a lot to come back to healing our generation and our children that are following our steps.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And Marcia posed a question at the beginning. I think Gloria, in some ways, responded to it. Diane, so can we also return to the question about institutions?
Thank you so much. I think in a word, conscious of time and cognizant that we're about to wrap up time. Institutions, what we're allowing, if you listen to everything that everybody has just said, already we are hearing an implied dynamic of power. And it's very important that we are very clear about this. So in terms of opening up spaces, I advocate for neutral spaces where we can listen, we can create deep listening spaces led by, as we're doing, modeled in this approach, community themselves. And a community, what are we talking about when we say community? Communities of practice, communities of interest, communities, there are various communities, you know, of geographical location, for example. And then I'd also like to thread in here the social justice pillars of voice. This is what Brother Shea just mentioned, also sister as well. Voice, participation, and representation on our terms. And so for me, the bedrock of all of this is equitable inquiry. Thank you.
Well, we're running out of time as always, and I think this is kind of a unmute yourself and we run out of time seem to be the two phrases repeated everywhere. I want to first of all thank everyone for your contribution, for sharing your experience. And secondly, I want to put a few words from our communities who are not with us. And for instance, I'd like to put this phrase that coming from Alan Charles Chipman. He's with us in the audience, I can see you. And because he says, from Richmond, he says, we cannot transform current systems without healing the harm perpetuated by these systems. So this is just important insight. And the other insight again from Richmond, he says, violent systems are dependent on us responding out of woundedness instead of healing. So in some ways that the elders has offered wisdom for us to follow. Now, just to wrap it up, as you all have talked about our ancestors, but also Diane talk about those yet to come, as we all know one day, those yet to come, those future generations who are yet to arrive where we are standing now, will pose such a question, such a question. What did our ancestors do when faced with legacies of enslavement, colonization, apartheid, genocide, and you name it? And I believe our speakers today from four continents have just provided the answer. Thank you, four of you, of course, Linda early, for pointing out a path for us to become good ancestors. So that concludes today's webinar, and the next one will be held on Friday the 10th November, featuring Dr. Gail Christopher in conversation with Rob Cochran on truth, racial healing, and transformation. Until next time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.